sir now?
Yes. Yes, one minute. Okay, you can start.
Can I start? Warm greetings. Okay.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon to all. Now we come to the final session of our two-day international webinar, Pen in the Time of Pandemics. And I hope that this final session would be an enlightening one to all literature lovers. Now, I would invite Dr. Abdullakutty Keppi for introducing our resource person today, Dr. Sabrina Lee. Sir, please.
Thank you, Mr. Renu. We have a very distinguished guest from Italy, Dr. Sabrina Lee. She's trained in classical Greek and Latin over a decade and is an Italian philosopher, author, translator, and cultural critic. She is the director of Tawassul Center for Publishing Research and Dialogue, a Rome-based independent think tank. She has so far authored over a half a dozen books and translated over 40 classics and other books from East to Italy. Some of her noted Italian translations are Abdullah Yusuf Ali's classic 1934 English Quran translation, Bhagavad Gita, Raja Ram Mohan Roy's Tuhfatul Muwahideen, A Gift to Monotheists, Muhammad Iqbal's Reconstruction of Religious Thought in Islam, and Malayalam film actor Innocence Cancer Wardile Chidi, Slogans of the Sage, a work on our beloved missionary Sayyid Muhammad Ali Shihab Tangal, authored by Mujib Rahman Jehu, and Mirza Hadi's Umrah Jan. Dr. Sabrina is currently working on her translation of Sahih al-Bukhari, Italian version of which 15 out of the planned complete 35 volumes of Sahih al-Bukhari have already come out. She has also translated a number of ancient Greek philosophical texts and poems into Italian, and Dr. Sabrina is currently doing the background work for her upcoming translations of a number of selected Upanishads into Italian. Dr. Sabrina's PhD is in ancient philosophy. For her master's degree, she specialized in Whittington's approach to language. Dr. Sabrina devotes her time to both interfaith literacy and understanding across different religions and cultures through various academic, literary, interfaith, and cross-cultural projects. Dr. Sabrina Lee's husband is Abdul Latif Chalikandi. He's an Indian scholar and public intellectual based in Rome. So we happily welcome Dr. Sabrina Ali for the audience to interact with them.
Good morning to all. Warm greetings and peace from Rome. Thank you very much for this kind invitation to join you on the occasion of this important webinar on PEN at the time of pandemics. I would like to thank especially the Department of English at the Shihab Tangal Memorial College, and especially the principal of the college, Dr. Anwar Shafi, Mr. Mohammed, the vice principal, and Mrs. Shaina, the head of the English department. This is very, it is an honor for me to be invited to deliver this the keynote address. I came to know this the popular leader and the cultural religious icon, Sayyid Shihab Tangal, on the occasion of the translation of the book Slogan of the Sage, collected by Mr. Jaihoon, that I got the possibility to translate into Italian language. And I got the chance to meet his son, who is the one who launched the book. This is in the first week of February in Dubai. It was an honor for me to meet Mr. Syed Monawar Ali on that occasion, and I got also the opportunity to engage and came to know other brothers and sisters from the Malappuram district. So it's always a pleasure for me to be and to address people in India that I consider my second homeland. So actually, my speech will be in two parts. So the first one will be in a general introduction, and which will be more the it will be quite this discourse will be based on few reflections about the challenges and the happenings that the world is currently going through. And the second part, it will focus mainly on a philosophical issue that actually is close, that as the audience will have the possibility to see, is quite connected, but goes to a deeper philosophical level. So actually, that as it's very easy to see, that this COVID time that creates all the challenges, all the difficulties, all the all the in its nature of a traumatic event, actually has got also in a way a positive aspect, because we see in this we saw in the first month of this pandemics and also in the following months, also the best aspect of humanity. We saw the selfless service of doctors, nurses, and people who work in the medical field, in the way in which they actually give them expose their own life, expose their own security in order to preserve and try to save other people's lives. From the other side, we got also the best responses and that rooted in a wise and merciful approach from religious, social, and some of the political leaders who show courage and humanity in leading the people among the pandemics. Also, but even when also in many parts of the world, and this is in the West as in the East as well, sometimes politicians and also social workers found themselves quite unprepared to face the challenges brought by this tragedy. We witness actually the heroic acts of individuals who selflessly that rediscover their own mission, not only in medicine but also in this as teachers, as social workers, as people who work among the society, and they rediscover their humanity, they rediscover their strength, and in facing all the challenges. And this actually is restore our faith in humanity. So in the middle of the tragedy, there is always a light of hope, and in the way in which the common people try to answer positively and constructively to the challenges that they are to face. We got from the East, from the West, different examples of doctors and nurses who gave their life in order to save other people, even if sometimes, most of the time, they were working at the beginning of the pandemics unprotected and without the basic sanitary form of protection against the virus. These examples have been reported, as in the case of the Dr. Madavi's story that has been well known in the West, saying that her story has been widely described and reported by the New York Times in the show of the 15th April of the current year. All these stories actually remind us of our common humanity. especially now when we see the enormous growth of radical nationalism, racism, and the communal bigotry in the contemporary world. So actually now in the contemporary world, in the middle of this difficult situation, because the pandemic didn't bring only enormous difficulties at the sanitary level due to the high mortality rate of this virus, but also because we see a disruption of the economy of several countries, and with the disruption and all the imbalances are actually slowly manifesting themselves. But and at the same time that we saw that the world was the time of the outburst of this pandemic, it was in the middle of an already ongoing crisis. Because that this is a phenomenon which doesn't belong only to a particular country, but it seems to involve countries as well in the East and the West, countries which minorities are living since a long time, or in the land of the new phenomenon of immigration, as for example Italy, or in other parts also of the West. And it seems that the political crisis which goes along with the economical one, it promotes the growth of radical nationalism, as I say, racism and the communal bigotry. So actually there is a current attempt of polarization. And what is the work of teachers, of authors, of writers, philosophers, public and intellectual, and is they have got the which is the their main mission now. They have tried to build harmony and harmony among the communities, harmony among the people. They should try to keep as much as possible people connected. They should they have got this all the secret I can say this sacred duty to keep humanity together, to be humanity connected. The challenge now is not only to fight from the sanitary level the spread of this virus, but also to build the human harmony and challenges the bigotry that harms our collective human consciousness. Because that the future is open in front of us, but we should find a new way to build it. We should find a new way to think about it. We should reconstruct our approach to the future. And we need actually now a new philosophical language, a new way of reading, a new cultural and intellectual discourse in relation to our identity. The new language that intellectuals that are called to speak, are called to perform, should be aimed to combat radical nationalism, bigotry, and all the cultural and racial exclusivist theories, which is that as we will see in the second part of this lecture, oneself is not insular or self-contained. It's not an entity which you can stand on. Or this is at the level of a single human being, or communities, or also nations. This statement can be read at different levels. So no singular entity is insular, but it's something that is ground and find its fulfillment in the fluidity of the relation with others. Actually, they see even when then a different discourse can be performed, we should address the situation from our side, because we know that the issue can be addressed socially, politically, but in the at the philosophical, literary level, we should address the situation throughout a humanistic religious discourse. We should try to protect human autonomy, freedom and dignity throughout an open, innovative and constructive reading of the religious sources without undermining their sacred and divine origins. So we should the need is to build an alternative both to a religious fundamentalist and anti-religious secularism. So is the need of the time is to find a middle path between a religious fundamentalist of different, we can assume different colors, and anti-religious secularism. Because religion and what is the religious feeling and the religious values, they got trapped in between these two forms of extremism. And in order to build the society in which religious fundamentalist is cornered and anti-religious secularism is balanced, we should learn how to respect religious and various other choice made by different people. So the people rights, the people freedom to choice is along with the freedom of conscience are inalienable human rights. And we should avoid to see human and social relations throughout the prism of us versus them. We should not, we should refuse the language of polarization, the language of mutual independent entities who at a personal, social, communal level, they face each other and they are engaged, not in a dialogue, but in a constant form of conflict. This is so, we should go, the crisis brought by this pandemic, it teaches us that we should harmonize our religious identity with our basic human identity. Religious identity is rooted in basic human identity. First, before belonging to a nation, to an ethnicity, or to a religious community, we are part of the same humanity. And this is the rampant and growing xenophobia could not be counteracted by another form of equally bigot xenophobia. This is actually the language of hatred, the language of conflict. It doesn't belong to a community, but as its inner quality. But it's something that is developed, or it's something that grows when there is a social dimension, when there is a political dimension, which whom are actually basically lacking of this mutual and understanding among the communities, among the people, and this reciprocal respect. The language of otherness should be the language of inclusivity. It should never be the language of conflict. When we polarize the us versus them, or and when we construct the image of the other, is we should not use the language of the otherness as something which cannot be included. So, but we should always see the language and the dialogue as a way of reaching out every form of otherness. And we should always remind to ourselves that violence and bigotry in the name of religious, morally and ethically, they undo the foundation of religion itself. Every religion has got always a universal appeal. This means that every religion, they assert a truth that is basically and by saying that is considered a revelation by their followers, has got a universal appeal. In order to have a universal appeal, every religion should be inclusive, should have a universal approach that they should share, and they try. Every religion has this is the duty of every religion is to build a society, is to build a ground, is to build a space which humanity as considered a creation of God as the possibility to grow, as the possibility to be respected in its own main feature. This is true of every religion. This is the challenge, actually, to build this space, to build this sacred space is the challenge that we are facing today. And this is the challenge of the people who are acting for peace. And the people who promote peace among communities, nation, and civilization. And in front of this a new form of institutionalized racism, xenophobia, and this I witness especially in Europe this new phenomenon that is assuming quite enormous proportion in the last few years. That we see that the racism, xenophobia in its various forms, actually, that is a way it provokes and promotes the regression of civilization and culture. Because if we are a student of history, we can, it's easy to see that. All the civilization they meet, mingle, and they exchange. So every civilization grew, is born and grew from the meeting of the encounter of previous civilizations. And if a civilization, a nation, a culture became extremely close in itself, and it stopped its growth and refinement. And it became his history gets stuck and started the decadence. Only when and the decadence extreme form of the language of otherness is not a symptom of strength, but is actually a symptom of extreme form of weakness. It's extreme form of weakness. To stop the dialogue, to prevent the dialogue, to create insular communities is a form of weakness that has been covered by a false appeal of strength. So when our language and discourse become extremely auto-referential, rooted in extreme form of self-identity politics, the borderline between our struggle for genuine social justice and ethnic chauvinism will vanish. So if we fight for justice, the justice cannot be rooted in nobody oppression. But the search for justice should be a universal search, it should be a universal struggle beyond culture beyond religion and beyond nationality or ethnicity. We should challenge, as I said, this discourse that is rooted in a false form of strength, but which reality covers a deep form of stagnation, weakness, and decadence of civilization. A community grows only if there is the changes, which if it is fluid. The fluidity doesn't mean to deny your own identity or to be apologetic about it, but this means to be ready to share it in a free cultural and religious and political space without imposition, but in the freedom of self-expression. So what should be stressed is our common humanity. In order to defeat racism and religious bigotry, we should build meaningful interfaith and cross-cultural relations among communities. What is the qualities that leaders should have in order to really build this space? And that these were the main feature of the personality of Shyam Thangal. That was also, as I learned from what I study about this great personality, and it was compassion, empathy, moral and ethical integrity, the ability to be non-discriminatory towards people on the basis of their religious, linguistic or ethnic origin, the ability to talk to people in their language, addressing their issues in a constructive way. So a language, or when we engage in a dialogue, we should always be, is our intention, the fulfillment of a dialogue, the aims of a dialogue should be always rooted in a good intention. And and when the political situation became extremely difficult, we should address it throughout the humanistic religious discourse. So a humanistic religious discourse is a discourse that is not only, as I said, religious means that can be shareable by people who belong to a given community, but is a humanistic discourse. So it's a discourse that try to address what is common among the people, try to address the needs of our common humanity. So what we appeal to, the concept to human autonomy, freedom, a dignity. These are values who can share, that are shared by all communities, all human beings that believe and they have got interest to preserve human autonomy, freedom, and dignity throughout an open, innovative, and constructive reading of the religious sources. And without, of course, undermining their sacred or divine origin, but we should always try to find what is common. We always try to find what can make us close, what can, because the duty of the day is to build a peaceful, just world, which is rooted in freedom, justice, and mutual respect. Actually, this is an alternative, as I said, to a form of bigotry, and this is actually a form of in a way to preserve what could be preserved in respecting the boundaries of the people, of people's freedom. This is actually, in terms of my personal experience, I actually translated different religious texts, and I translated the Holy Quran in Italian. I translated also Gita, and I translated both that have been reminded at the beginning of this seminar of texts belonging to different religious or cultural tradition that are different from the Western one. This is not a form of syncretism, but this is a form of giving value or giving importance to every human experience. In order to gain respect and to ask for respect, we should also know each other, to make the effort of knowing each other. Now that I will try deeper in the actually in the discourse that we already did, but from a more philosophical point of view. So which is I said before that our linguistic framework, so our language should be universal, inclusive and deeply human. This will lead us to understand that the human culture and civilization are hybrids, inclusive and mutually dependent. But what is the relation between this new approach that we are proposing, that it is actually at the opposite side of the main discourse? So I will try now to share with you some consideration of philosophical order that are quite related to what is happening now or at the time of COVID-19. So we try to read what is the psychological impact of this virus and how single human beings can actually reflect and after reflection reach to the conclusion that has been explained at the beginning of the seminar. Actually, as we saw that there is a critical situation now, as said, due to the spread at our boss of this deadly virus. And the spread of this disease actually abrupt stop to the normal activities related to both the work and the free time. The impact at a personal level, at a different level, has been enormous. Actually, we can make a distinction between different levels of impact of these pandemics. The first is personal, the second is social, and the third one is political. These three levels are however connected, interconnected to each other. And ultimately, this dimension can assume a new nuances and meaning from the passage from what I call the passage from individualism to individuality. So, as we know, that is actually through everyone knows about how now, especially at the political level, through media, through fake news, through a spread of continuously flow of information that most of the time are full of prejudice, most of the time are constructed for political aims. The relation between the person and the political level got reversed. As I said, we have got three levels. The first is personal, the second is social, the third one is political. Actually, now, in the pre-COVID time and even during these pandemics, the political and social, they got the upper hand on the personal level. This means that the the single individual, they don't have the time, they don't have the space, they don't have the opportunities to reflect about the distinction between truth and untruth, right and wrong. So they are actually became the victim of a flow, of overflow of information that the aim is to change and to mold the way in which they look at the world. And this is actually true in every part of the world. Now, at the time, why I spoke about the passage from individualism to individuality. And now we see that in the pre-COVID time, we got a society which is individualistic society. And then we see what does it mean. The personal life, as I say, due to the abrupt the abrupt stop of social interaction does not pass doesn't have any more it's not anymore in front of a reflective mirror of social relationship and interaction, but assume an eminently intimate dimension. So due to the social distance, to the different lockdowns that actually put a stop to the normal social interaction or make it assume them or put them at a different level, we pass from a social level in which the individual is in the constant presence of a reflecting mirror which he see himself and the world and the happenings of the world through a mirror of social webs or media webs. But at the time of COVID, he has got the possibility to assume an intimate dimension. So the individuality passed from what is the dimension of extreme social involvement to an eminently intimist dimension. The intimist dimension, which is the personal dimension, forces and promotes a new relation with time. So, as we know, if we think about our, which is the relation between human life and time, we can reflect on the fact that due to the lockdown, due to the stop of social interaction, due to the stop to normal activities, time became slow. So time became stretched indefinitely and violence except indefinitely. It became like an empty space which should be actually filled. Before time of the people were continuously filled by activities, interaction. But if we assume an intimistic attitude, our life, our time became in a way at the beginning, at the moment of the challenges, at the moment of the of our personal approach with the disease became like an empty space. So we find a kind of empty space, and the time itself assumed the character of extraneity. The suspension of the normal daily activities assume a new contours, and and actually humanity is called to assume a new individual consciousness where the needs, the tasks and the dynamics of the daily life became suspended in a temporal dimension, which becomes actually eminently individualistic. So we are actually in front of we are in front of the rediscover. We are in front of the discovering of a new, more original and individual dimension. we will have an impact also on the influence in the way in which each human being look at the society. We can think that this lockdown, this abrupt interruption of our normal social interaction, we should see as a way of approaching life and our personal dimension through a different way. As I see, as I said before, we have we are in front of the passage from individualism to individuality. Actually, at individual level, the abrupt interruption and the change of the daily habits and normal social interaction, even if it has been a traumatic event, actually, and then got a traumatic and a nature, has got also some positive connotation. We have got there is a through this separation we can reach a reawakening of a new dimension through which look at the new dimension of time, and we also to the in, of a new interior dimension of our personal relation with ourselves, the world, and the time. Time actually is a concept that connects to the personal individuality of every human being and has got a high spiritual dimension. As we saw, when we think about the dimension of time, in the normal social intercourse, social relation, we have got a external dimension that goes straight from the past to the future, passing through the present. So the time assume is can be understood as a line, as so has got an external dimension. But when we go, when we retreat from individualism from to individuality, the time goes deep into the interiority of a person. What is so let's speak now what is individualism and what is individuality. So when I speak about individuality, I don't speak only at the personal level, but I speak about that we got individualism can be not only of can cannot be cannot all a characteristic of the single individual, but it can be also a characteristic of the people, of a community, of a nation, of an ethnicity. The individualism can be defined as a tendency to devaluate the interests of the society and collectively and collectivity in the name of someone personally independent or egocentric. So actually, individualist society, or in the individualist self, or individualist ego, is an ego, or a community, or a nation, which sees the fulfillment of its interests at the detriment of other people's interests. So this is actually, we can call the individualist ego as the conflictual ego. And this leads human beings, nations, community, to a progressive estrangement from their true selves. But when we pass from individualism to individuality, we see, we rediscover a new personal, genuine dimension in relation to the time and space. This dimension, then, while the individualist dimension is destructive for the human being as well as of cultural civilizations, because promote the language of conflict, the language of otherness, is if we rediscover the true individuality, we assume a more genuine human approach, which is actually deeply spiritual. So the approach of related to individuality is deeply spiritual, and we have an impact on the society as a whole. This is if we rediscover what is the deep impact of the passage from individualism to individuality, we rediscover a more original dimension, which will have a strong impact and influence to the way in which human beings look at the society, in which civilization look at the other civilization and the history of the world, and the way in which the community interacts with each other. Individualism, as I said, needs a way of social relation to expressing itself and through which manifests its condition of immature ego or immature self, which is actually incapable to assert its own individuality beyond a social dimension. So individualism, which is due to its aggressiveness, to its immaturity, to its incapacity of connecting, to its incapacity of understanding that its own interest is part of the interest of a whole humanity, and its interest cannot always be read in opposition to other individuals, is a self which is the same, which is at the same time trying to reach freedom from others, but need others in a constant, to be in a constant conflict condition. We have a society now in which is formed by a series of individualism, and a society which is individualist is a society where the main feature are, so the main feature of individualist society is division, conflict, competitiveness. Individualistic society in the West, but it's in the West, this is as your individualist society manifests itself through extreme form of liberism in economical field, and hedonism at the moral and ethical side. But in other cultures and civilization, which are maybe more traditional, is expressed in a different way and assume a different social and political connotation, both in the East and in the West. But actually, this is what we see, the manifestation of what of the society, of the at the level of the polity, or level of politics or social interaction, but in the East, in the West, even if expressed with different language or with got a different phenomenological manifestations, actually is rooted in this individualistic society, in which, as I said, the main feature are division, conflict, competitiveness. Actually, individualist ego, or individualist self, or the immature ego, interpret the dimension of personal realization and the self-development often as in conflict with the wider interests of the community. And there is a false sense of independence and a false sense of freedom. Before the first part of the seminar, we spoke about the fact that a close civilization who became extremely rooted in its close, rooted in itself, and assume the language of the otherness in a conflictual way, he is showing actually a false strength, but is on the path of on the path of decadence. Actually, the same thing at in the individual itself there is a sense of false independence and false freedom, because the individualist ego is not truly independent, is not truly free, cannot be neither independent neither free, because it is in real nature, is deeply dependent on the society and the rules of social relations, through which is conflictual and aggressive individuality can be expressed. This means that if the individualistic ego doesn't have a social web, social relation, which is structured in a given way, he cannot express himself. He cannot, because being deeply conflictual, deeply being aggressive, is by definition always out of himself. So the individualist ego is never, could never be spiritual, could never be rooted in it, or can never assume a meditative attitude, because it can exist only in the conflictual relation with other ego existing in the society. Now, what happened in the time of COVID, this ego rediscovered itself while confronting or facing challenges as loneliness, as helplessness, as emptiness. So the individualist ego, when is out of conflict, can and cannot rediscover its true self. And actually, the individual self, instead, contrary to the individualistic one, is the truly independent self. Because his independence, so the independence of the spiritual ego, the real individuality, does not mean freedom from the society or freedom from other people. Or because this, but the kind of independence searched from by the individualist ego, which is can be found only, and the individualist ego can accept himself only in the conflict with other egos in order to gain a progressive freedom from dependency, in a disparate, never-ending process. Because so if this we can think about at the personal and communal community or civilization, a civilization or a person which is which rooted in individualism and is continually projected out of himself. But at the same time, doesn't recognize and the rights of others, it in the process of asserting its own individuality, destroy what actually is sustaining, because its needs of social recognition, of assertion of strength, assertion of power will never end. And this is especially true when different people or different individualities assume the same individualistic attitude. And if we think about this individualistic attitude that assumed also by community and civilization, we see that if everyone try to assert his own individuality at the detriment of others, the language of conflict, the language of violence, the language of polarization or dehumanization of the other became endemic, like a deadly virus. And then all the world peace is destroyed, as well as the personal peace. We should understand that it's always a cross relation between what is happening at the interiority of human being and what is happening in the society. This is not both of them, they influence each other. And if there is an healthy human beings, if a human being is healthy in his own interiority, is deeply spiritual in his own interiority, will have the lack of conflict in the society. When I say that we have only a form of religious bigotry that propone religious or even social values or political values, can assume different levels, and only for the sake of a kind of phenomenological feature, and actually we'll have the conflict will spread, and then we will, even if we assume different colors, we are all the same. So, but because the independence is never, the independence is always moral and ethical. The moral subject is independent, scientist is moral responsible. So the individual moral responsibility and the ethical decision are the consequence of human freedom. So when the instead of individualistic approach, which is rooted in otherness, in conflict, in searching the other in order to assert it in himself, the individual self, the spiritual self, the mature one, the developed one, is a moral subject, is an independent and moral, an ethical subject, because he recognizes his duty, he recognizes to be responsible, and he recognizes the responsibility and the ethical decision that he sees as a consequence of human freedom. And the independence and the independence is structured in relation to the need to understand the structure, the web of relation are deeply human. So the real dependence in, sorry. I think that I have to. Okay, other 5 minutes. I think I have 5 minutes just to complete. And what I said, what is teaching us the fact that abruptly we find the impossibility to interact normally with each other. Our personal freedom, in a way, has been constricted by the movements, by that not only out of the country, of going abroad, but moving in the country or even in the district that where we live. This is it will make us to help us in a way to understand that what is the meaning of our life, or the meaning of our way of being in the society, in being in this world, is never that, is always rooted in our deep spiritual attitude. So we should always read, we should become able to read at the world and the society with a way of openness, in a way of an ethical approach. An ethical approach, a moral approach, is that one of responsible moral ethical subjects who recognize that his freedom, as his independence, is not rooted in an aggressive attitude or in the attempt to gain at the detriment of other people rights, but is always passed through an ethical decision. So the decision, the choice, is always personal, and through a deep personal choice that every personal human being as individual is called to a personal choice in every moment of his life, independently for what the media of what political parties or propaganda of cultural, political or other type of propaganda are actually try to inspire or try to mold the decision of the masses. Through a new spiritual intimacy and individual approach to our interiority, we can change the way in which we look at our life at our society and the way in which we look at the world. We should understand that what is the meaning of human freedom, and what is the meaning of human responsibility at the personal, social, and political level. And this also will help us to develop a new relation with time, a new relation with space, which is not, because now we see time as something that run fast and consume the human being. But we should try to see time as something that is still to go straight, goes deep in our interiority. So let's have this tragic moment of COVID time, which in which everyone stressed to his own or her own possibility and capacity as a way of rediscovering our interiority, is a way to understand that our future is a moral responsibility of all humanity, and then the choice is always a personal and moral choice. Thank you very much. Thank you very much again for the invitation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sabrina Ma. It was an enthralling session on reading and reflection. Now this session is open for discussion. Abdul sir, please ask.
So thank you, Dr. Sabrina, for having a very philosophic but very interesting topic, how we have to come out of the individualistic or individualism that is ruling the roost in the present time. So my kind question for you is, as a bridge between East and West, as a bridge between East and West and between many faiths, can you see any change after the pandemic that all Europe, which was very busy in civilizing the East, now having any lessons from the East or the marginalized world around? So is there any, this pandemic bring any kind of lessons for the civilizations to meet, as you said, a meeting point, a meeting place, rather than a conflict point?
Yes, of course, because actually, when it's a time of crisis, in terms of we are in front of an invisible enemy, and an enemy doesn't differentiate. So we don't have now East against the West, or I don't know, we are not the time of crusade. So, but we are at the moment in which not only the fact that, of course, the virus can affect everyone independently from his age, from his social status, from ethnicity, or communal or religious belonging. So actually that virus is teaching us that every human being has got the same value, but not only has got the same value, but it's teaching us that every human being has got the same weakness. So every human being could be a victim of the same disease, and this teaches us that the equality of every human beings, actually. And we always see the discourse of the East and West as always. East and West actually is a philosophical construction. is a political, deeply political and philosophical construction, as stipulated, because the West is assert itself in opposition to the East. This actually we see that the discourse of individualism as a macro level of the fiction of two great civilizations, but actually East and West, they always interact with each other. From centuries, there was always be interaction. There was always be a mutual exchange. There always been they grow through influencing each other at the same level. The problem is at the detriment of the fact that when there is one civilization wants to assert its superiority, but the superiority through a false form of strength, which is actually a false form of strength that cover the intention of the intention of using and misusing the trust. So civilizations should learn to trust each other and trying to find a point of mutual exchange for the sake of all humanity. All of us we can learn from each other. Everyone can feel we can feel the extreme interest to have this encounter. This is what sometimes the language of violence, the language of the otherness, rooted in conflict, is actually what they want to prevent the dialogue. Most of the time, this superstructure of us versus them, or West versus East, is actually wants to prevent the encounter, the meeting, and the hybridation of civilization, which is actually always happened in the course of human history.
You hear that?
Maria.
Some interruptions from the audience, sorry.
Ah.
Okay. What will be your reflections on Indian experiences of diversity? As you pointed out, there is no superior self and inferior other. So Indian diversity for centuries of religions, regions, languages, and now the Europe also is experiencing the multiculturalism, the debates on multiculturalism. So what will be your advice for the Indians? Shall we continue the diversity shall we go for monolithic cultural identity, or shall we continue the diversity from your experiences, from both in, as you mentioned, India as your second home? So what is your advice for Indians from the experience?
So diversity, so we should reflect, so diversity is in us. It's part of us. So we don't have identity without diversity. So this is a philosophical discourse that has been developed in the West after the Second World War and the tragedy of mass killing in the Holocaust. This has been diversity and identity and otherness are actually a part of us, a part of every human being. So at the experience of Europe, which is actually a century ago, that they passed through a phenomenon of mass destruction as this, in the Second World War, which is even worse than the First World War, that the just lapse of a few years, and between them, this is a great lesson that we can have, that diversity and identity are deeply connected in the human being. Diversity is in us because we are all different from each other. But and also diversity cannot exist without an identity. Identity is the capacity of reflecting. Identity is to recognize the person recognizes his own individuality throughout a series of features. But this the identity is always static. But we cannot think about identity without diversity, because the diversity is what makes us move forward. And this is true for every human being, in which the identity of a child is not the identity of a grown-up man. So the identity of a young girl is not the identity of a mother. It's not when she's grown up. This I want to mean that identity of a person, which is rooted, pass through different challenges, pass through different growth only if he or her they have the freedom of interaction and self-expression. Now, if we can think about identity, we can think about identity as that of a human being who grow up in a forest without any kind of social interaction, which is he will keep his identity. I make this extreme form of example to show that without history, without interaction, without having a positive relation with with time, it's not possible to develop your own self. So, and if it's real at the individual level that diversity is part of identity, and diversity is what makes us move on, because diversity is what triggers us. Diversity are the challenges to come through the historical progress. It is also true at the level of communities. So at the level of communities, you can keep your own identity, but at the same time you can actually exchange with other communities your experience, because this is actually a way of the meaning of sharing a space. So in the case of India, which is a great nation, it's a continent which is full of potentialities, cultural, economical, and political. So what is the aim? So actually different communities, they should think which kind of space I am sharing with the other communities. So your motherland is one. So you should try to develop or give the best of your capacity to it in order to benefit. Because as I said before, if the moral and the personal individual level, they made a moral choice, which is a spiritual choice, which is a choice based on human freedom, or if you want to think about the religious level, about the deepest teaching of the religious, of someone religion, that basically is always a positive. There is always a positive attitude. But of course, this is an effort, because when the environment is difficult, but this is not only in India, this is also everywhere. The political environment is different in every part of the world. But we should always try to understand that there is always a person, the choice is always personal. That we should try to do is to try to limit the way in which society push us towards some kind of reactions. This is a very difficult thing to do. It's not easy, but we need a new way. So we need a new approach, and as you said, a new language, a new way of constructing. Constructing and reading, interpreting our own human and in personal experience. You see, then this is also very important about this open chat about what is the meaning of language, how we use the language. The language describe us, or we describe things through the language. Most of the time, language is something which molds us. And make the language can make it flourish or make us make a civilization go down. So there is always this component. This is the reason why we need a new language of inclusiveness, and as a new language of an approach which is or grounded in mutual understanding. This is actually an effort which is not a symptom of weakness, to say that, we are the minority, so we have to be apologetic, we have to be the one who make the first step, so we can say, no, this is not what I mean. So this is true, this is not only true for Muslims, not only true for Hindus, it's not only true for Western or Americans or Italians or whatever, but this is true of every human being. This is his personal and as well at the level of communities, nations, and civilization. Such as for community, or such is always the one who makes the first step, is always the one at the time of crisis has got the originality to elaborate a new language in which to describe the world and to give, because through a new language we give to the people new eyes to see the world. But if through the language of conflict, the language of supremacists, if we construct, we also mold a world, and we mold not only a world, but the eyes through which people look at it. I hope that's been clear.
So you see that the contemporary writing, is there any connection between the geographical area? That the contemporary writings have any geographical connection. You have been going through certain style of writings and the area you have connected so many countries also. That's why I'm asking, is there any connection? What's your opinion about that?
Yeah, this is actually the importance of, of course, that every language has got a cultural connotation, and this cultural connotation is actually sometimes very difficult to understand for someone who is coming from another culture. And this is speaking mainly about my work as a translator, and every language is molded in the personal experience of the people. And every language brings the history of the people who speak it and who spoke it in the past. But also language is not something that or fixed forever, as for example it could be the dead language that I studied in the past when I was young, like Greek and Latin. But the language is in a constant form of evolution. So, as I said, the language can evolve in very different ways. and can be a way of and can be a way in which is an instrument through which you search for you are open to the world, or can be a way of self-assertive discourse. But of course, that I think the what I noticed when I translate, for example, when I study Indian literature, that beyond, of course, I do it through the mediation of English. So actually, there was the first layer of actually unlocking some of the concepts that's been done by the people who translated to English. So do it to Italian, it could be much easier. But I think there is a, you can see that for people who are interested in this literature, especially Indian literature, subcontinent literature, now in Italy it's becoming quite a trend. And because they see something which is, there is something which not only is curiosity of how people deal with some issues in different cultural civilization, but you cannot get deeply involved if you don't recognize the existence of a real, a mutual understanding among the people. So if there is no a common humanity, if there is no a common substratum, there is something which common that unites us despite the difference of languages. There is nothing that can be, we cannot understand each other. It could be impossible. This makes me think about what is in the Bible about the tower of Babel, no? That there is this myth in the Bible which at the beginning humanity was one, so they spoke the same language, they got the same, they were worshiping the same God, they got the same culture, you can see. But there they wanted to build a tower so high to reach the sky, so to reach God. So actually Babel means the door to God in Hebrew. And this is that they were actually punished for it. But what I want to mean that at the beginning this myth in the Bible want to actually underline the common nature of humanity as the fact that different civilizations grow after the destruction of this tower. So means actually the destruction of the primordial unity of humanity is not a curse, but this is from the Jewish Christian point of view has been a curse. But from if I can speak about what Islam says, no, it's not a curse, but it is a blessing. Because the blessing of knowing each other, understanding each other, not undermine each other, not going to conflict with each other. So this is what I mean, that among human beings we got this, this is not got the same rights, we got the same freedom, because we got the same human dignity, independently from how we express it in some nuances of our culture. But what is important is that we exchange with each other freely, and we learn from each other. And I think literature, even before, because philosophy sometimes is very tough to read, not everyone is not suitable for anyone, because sometimes it doesn't appeal to a large audience. But what is really is much appealing is the literature, because literature there is always a human experience that is, as we can see, the same human experience clothed with the different cultural schemes. Or I hope to have been clear.
Yeah, ma'am. I just asked this question because you have translated so many works into Italian language. That's why I asked this question, that because is there any type? You have clearly told about the view. Thank you so much for the answer.
Thank you.
Okay, is there any more questions?
I think one of our you to watch Gomadi Kandasamy has a simple question on how we can read the things for the beginners. For the beginners, what kind of reading we have to suggest? Gomadi Kandasamy, maybe a general question for you.
Mm-hmm. So this means to have this new approach.
Yeah.
So I think it's very easy because everyone should go on to the root of his own civilization founding books text. The problem is that this I could see this actually I got the possibility to see from my experience of my readings and studying that the foundational text of every civilization are always they show the strength of the civilization, so they are all inclusive. So I could see that this is of course that Quran in the foundational text of all Hinduism, the Quranic revelation, even that the Christian Gospels, they are all of the Jewish Bible, they were all actually inclusive at the beginning, because in the beginning a civilization is strong, is open, is not fearful to lose nothing, but they always wants to, but is always eager to gain in a positive way. It's always a young civilization is always wants to learn, is always wants to develop, is always is full of strength and power intended in a good way. But in the long run, with the long experience, we see that people who commented on this foundational test, most of the time assume a very much exclusive attitude, the attitude of self-preservation, closeness, attempt to maintain maintain their own identity and the face of weakness. And this, for example, I can give you two examples from two different civilizations. Everyone knows that, as you know, in Andalusia, there's been ruled, so part of Spain, the south part, has been ruled by Muslims for several centuries. And we see, if we analyze the fiqh about the relation between the communities, so means the jurisprudence relation to the way of interaction between Muslim community and other communities, because in Andalusia there were Muslim community, Jewish community, and Christians. So we see, if we read the development of this jurisprudence in relation to the development of political power. At the time of consolidation of the political power of the Arabs in the peninsula, that we see that there was a close interaction between the communities. Intermarriage was actually promoted. Was promoted because this is at every level, at the upper level, in order to create of course the political alliances. But the one that when the Muslim civilization in Spain was strong, they didn't fear interaction, they didn't fear connection, they didn't fear exchange. With the passage from the time of Umayyad's power to the small kingdoms, we see that the prospect changes. Why? because that all the jurisprudence, the main scholars, they were putting boundaries between the communities because they were fearful. They were fearful of to lose the what remain of their political independence. They were actually fearful to lose their identity. So this is quite this happens every this happens to every civilization. If we think about what happened to the Jewish diaspora, when there are some Jewish that religion was in a way before the destruction of the Second Temple in this the second century after Christ, what was a universal religion, because a lot of pagans, they were converting to the monotheism, but later that was assumed also the a feature of exclusiveness due to the diaspora, loss of political power, loss of security. So the fact that find yourself as a minority in an hostile environment, it promotes this kind of attitude that is an attitude of weakness. So what we should do? We should try to go back to the foundational text of our foundational text of each civilization, and we will see that we find there the language of a strength, the language of a true strength, that is the language of true spirituality, which teach us to be inclusive, teach us to move forward, they teach us to be, to create a dynamic way of interaction, to bring always the positive. So we should we should develop a spirituality which is the development of a positive intention. So we should develop a positive intention in our interaction, and this is true for personal human being, for individuals, for nations, and for civilizations. So the discourse is the same, even if it is expressed phenomenologically at different levels. I hope that's been clear.
Is there any more questions? Okay, that brings the end of our open discussion. Thank you, Dr. Sabrina, ma'am, for your profound interaction on humanity, individualism, and its varied realities. I would invite Mr. Mohammed, Vice Principal, for closing remarks. Sir, please.
Audible?
Yes, sir. You are
audible.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Have a good presentation by Dr. Sabina Lee on the reflections of this time. In this time, we are quarantined or locked down in our own spaces. From this space, she provoked us to think ourselves, to be individual, and to go into ourselves, to understand ourselves. And I think that this may be the great reflection of this pandemic season. By this season, we could understand ourselves. Your presentation started from different levels of political and media and information overflow, which and manipulations which made the community hated and the formation or the formation of radical nationalism and bigotry, and later, and the way you presented the points is marvelous. First, you started from the differences that existed in our communities, societies worldwide, and now enter into and establish their dichotomy, which will make us understand what is individuality and individualistic approach. And in individualistic ego, we know that it will make isolation, loneliness. In this time, we know that if we have an individualistic ego in this quarantine time, it will lead us to suicide itself. So what we understand from your thought is that the spiritual ego or the individuality which lead us to diversity itself, by making our identity, we could go to a diverse world, understanding a diverse world and inclusive without hatred, understanding our people, understanding the world, understanding different races, caste, creed. And this session was a different session which immersed in philosophy and which will make us think differently, act differently, not getting information, not getting mere information, or going through the theories after and after, but to make us change, to make us think. And I'm very much grateful and thankful to Mr. Dr. Sabrina Ali for participating in our session and making it a grand thing. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Mohammed sir, for your kind words. Now, let's invite Mrs. Sahina, Head of English Department, to propose a vote of thanks.
Annie ma'am is on the way. She will join now. I think for felicitation, Annie ma'am is on the way. Within seconds, she will be here. Shall wait for 1 minute.
Okay, ma'am.
She has joined here and again she has been leaving from the group. I think there is some type of technical issue is going. So shall go to the concluding section.
Yeah, if she can join, she will be there. By the way, you can move on to concluding remarks. Thanking the event for.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you. Warm greetings to everyone. To be spiritually awake, humanly loyal, and morally honest is the essence of SMSTM, Arts and Science, Women's College, mission on education. Acquire the knowledge and impart it to the people. Quoted words of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The concept of education, we know that the success is not the only target, but it's a journey of growth by receiving. First of all, I thank the Almighty for the countless blessings, and I express my sincere apology for the inconvenience faced in the first session because of technical issues. We can't play it on online. That session will be definitely uploaded on the channel soon. So we are so grateful to all those who remained patient and supported us. Thank you for making this two-day international webinar a memory to carry. On behalf of our SMSTM family, I deem it's a privilege, a great privilege, to propose the vote of thanks on this validation moment. At first, I raise my heart in gratitude to the Honorable Member of the Parliament, Ms. Kanimori, the poet, who initiated in our webinar. Through her inaugural speech, it graced the event, and the very presence of her in her busy, extremely busy schedule as a reflection of the importance she gave for the education. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to place my record, my sincere thanks and gratitude to our most respected manager, Mr. Muhammad Ali, known for his boundless support to conduct such an event. And thank you for the numerous cooperation. And yes, the 2 days just bloom with the galaxies of intellectuals. I heartily congratulate all for your active participation and support. And my words are not enough to express the gratitude. We are so grateful to you, Dr. Abida Farooqi, Assistant Professor of English, Government Arts and Science College, Kondoti, Malappuram, Kerala, India, for all words of wisdom and that radiated a source of energy within us for the thought-provoking session to read literature from a different perspective view. Thank you for being with us, ma'am.
It's been a pleasure.
I express my indebtedness to Dr. Maryam Abdullah Hashimi, Ibrahim Hassan Al Hashimi, Assistant Professor, College of Islamic and Arabic Studies, UAE, for the captivating sitting on the topic, Pen and the Pandemic, for the different view of silence. She had gone through the different views of silence and words. Thank you for being with us. And thank you for sharing your knowledge. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation and profound gratitude to Dr. Sunidha Srinivasi, Associate Professor and Principal in Charge, Government College Mukherjee, Kerala, India, for keeping us spellbound by your persuasive lecture and insight of which it had opened a new vista of knowledge about the ailing bodies and ailing world. Thank you, ma'am. I heartfelt thanks to Dr. Sabrina Lee, Italian philosopher and author and director, Sassuolo Center for Dialogue and Research, Rome, Italy, for keeping the audience spellbound through her mesmerizing thought on reading and reflection, humanity during and beyond pandemics, which enlightened the mind of the 21st century learners. And the event of this started rolling months in advance. I have been fortunate enough to be backed up of very motivated and dedicated colleagues who have shown their willingness beyond their comfortable zone. And I'm also lucky to have them. So first of all, I would like to thank, I would take this opportunity to thank place a record, my sincere thanks to our beloved principal, Dr. Anwar Shafi, for his positive support and guidance in campaigning the event. And I express my profound gratefulness to our progressive thinker, Vice Principal Mr. Mohammed, for his excellent coordination in organizing this program. I would like to take this opportunity to render my heartly thanks to Mrs. Nuzepa, our former HOD of our college, for being the part of the event. And my sincere gratitude to our Commerce and Psychology Department for their kind encouragement, and special thanks to Mrs. Jasila and HOD, Head of the Department of Commerce, and Sharif, Mr. Sharif, Head of the Department of Psychology. I thank Mr. Safwan, Assistant Professor of Commerce, Ms. Shadia, Assistant Professor of Psychology, and our beloved officer staff, Mr. Ilyas and Mr. Rasi, who worked beyond the screen. Because of them, the event had gone so smooth. Thank you. No words of appreciation and to my department partners, Dr. Abdullah Kuti and Ms. Renu Rajisha, who moderated the sessions and worked around the clock to make it done according to our expectation. Finally, I appreciate to all participants who made the event with your active participation. And yes, I'm very happy with the sheer number of students who shaped the platform to make it better. Thanks to Mrs. Shahla, Mrs. Jeffla Nasser, Ms. Midunauni, and Ms. Kartiga to ensure the event from up to down. And certainly my gratitude to all friends and my family for extreme support. Thank you for being with us. It has been a great pleasure. So with the quote of Mahatma Gandhi, live as if you were to die tomorrow, learn as if you were to live forever. Thank you for being with us. Thank you very much for your cooperation. Thank you. Thank you so much. We I think that the participants are